La main morte. The dead hand. En ce temps-là, in that time, in the 77th year of this reign, while the rest of the world was shared between pleasure, starvation and war, a very small kingdom, circled by seas, seemed to wrap itself. Treading the heavy necklace of days, everyone was adorning oneself, when, from this very small kingdom, a voice came up like a cry over the graves. The voice of a princess and her cavalier. She was so beautiful that when she appeared, no one would dare ask him where she was from. A princess in exile, black hair up, blood lips, her black eyebrows scratching with two accents the white skin of her face. Haughty and unpenetrable, she would wear boots and playing with her legs to jump like a crazy dog, dancing her revenge over the poison-hardened childhood, while the rest of the world was only desolated walls, violence, and pain. Not far from there, by the River Thames, in their garden of fantasy and curiosity, two princes who, as any prince, only loved in everything beauty and courage, spent most of their time drawing, painting, writing in notebooks or playing instruments. Being friends, they would hardly speak as they both preferred pure sound to any talk. But the princess, having heard about them, as they had heard about her, wanted to meet them, and as soon as she did, proposed them this pact. My voice is equal to your instrument. I can play with its chords as you do, and words coming out are my notes. Follow me. We'll be four of us, all equal. The voice, the beat, the bass, and the chords. And we will say with it the song of the soul of earth, having nothing between us but one low emotion. Astonished, but seduced by the passion of the princess, whose eyes were sending lightning, they both accepted. And she was right. The music which aroused them from her energy and their delicateness exploded like a diamond. As they traveled a lot, playing from one end of the kingdom to the other, the news spread quickly. In each town, one ran to see them. The following year happened to be beautiful and difficult. The voice of the princess and her look were getting more pure every day. Her force was growing. The words seemed to place themselves on the sound they were discovering. Soon, their success was so big and unexpected that the chancellor of the king, who took account of his gains, which happened to be much more than he first thought, presented himself in great honor with all his company and bowed at the feet of the princess, who was so proud that no flattery ever could move her, and he said to her, "Madam, His Majesty the King is so satisfied and charmed by your beauty that he sent me to offer you this reward, being certain that you will soon deserve much bigger honor." On hearing these words, the princess, although very troubled, and in spite of the slightly red face of the merchant, who didn't smile, just thanked the king for his kindness. But as soon as he left, with his equipage, she went on laughing, jumping as she used to like it. "Wonderful," she said. "Oh, my friends, we'll be the best. We have to." And not hiding her joy anymore, she fixed her dark eyes on those who were close to her. The princess stood, standing like statues, and who had not said a word during the whole scene, kept impassive. Childishness, flattery, said the other. "But, as it seems to be your pleasure, no ceremony, please." The wounded princess, incredulous, got darkened all of a sudden. But the blonde cavalier, faithful by her side, took her hand, brushing the incident away. "Your musicians are certainly very magnificent, but they seem so dark and distant. Your voice is so beautiful. Why don't you put them in the background as a magnet? So that the princess, although very true, got convinced with time that there was not anything else to do and forgot about her engagement. Why should I refuse to please anyone? Where could there be any prejudice? Aren't we gifted and free? One has, said the princess, to be faithful to oneself and one's oath. And, as each one of them seemed to keep misunderstood, they gradually ceased any discourse. 2 years had already passed, but the princess, more and more distant, would show up very rarely, and pale would lock themselves, whispering dark things to each other. The princess, troubled, was looking forward to better moments, hoping that the perspective of a next voyage would wake them up from their obstination. But nothing happened, and on this statement, they left for the north. On the very day of their arrival, the princess ran all over the town to the crowd. The princess behind her, like shadows, would stay dumb and staggered. Until that moment when, for some reason, like a cloud on the troubled spirit, she in fury threatened her. Treason. From the eyes of the princess, a dagger look came, and the princess had not yet retrieved a fist, still in the air. Blown away, taking the music. The anger which was to follow was colossal. They better die, she wailed, and anyone who happens to meet them must kill them in my name. They were nothing to me anyway. They're only traitors. That night, the child in love came shivering on the doorstep while she was trying to collect herself. In the shadow behind her, instruments laying down, sending strange glitter. The child, taking the instrument in his arms like a